Hi everyone, welcome to the Sea Brigade.
Hello.
My name's Ken.
I'm Emily.
And today we're covering Broadchurch Series 3, Episode 6. And
oh, yeah.
While we're just drowning in stuff to talk about, I have some emails that we need to read first from our lovely listeners.
Yay, emails, plural.
Yes. So, Sarah Jo writes, "Hi, I'm a listener in the UK and I enjoy your podcast a lot. I've been thinking about the fact that we know Sarah sent the anonymous text to Trish, but we still don't know why. What does Sarah want Trish to shut up about? I'm sure Trish said she didn't have much contact with Sarah early in the season and that Trish avoided her at the party. That makes me wonder if Ian was somehow spying on Trish through the laptop and Sarah somehow found out about it, as well as finding some evidence that Trish was spreading rumors or facts harmful to Sarah digitally. Keep up the work. Good work. Sarah Jo."
Thanks, Sarah Jo.
Yeah, so so that came in before episode 6 aired, and I was like, oh, right, the Sarah plot. And,
this is true.
They didn't pick up, but I would, you know.
But we did talk more about the laptop this week, so, yeah.
Yeah, cool. and I wouldn't rule out Sarah, because if she did was send the text message for no reason, that it's going to be really, you know, there'll be a head-scratcher if in the next, if in the next two episodes there's no, like, why was Sarah a character? So that should probably come back. And also, I think the top theory about what Leo did to the laptop, in my opinion at least, is probably install some kind of, like, keep the webcam on even if it looks like it's powered off, or, you know, be able to just, like, look and see what's going on in the house.
Sketchy shit, Ian.
We also have an email from Jalola.
Yay!
Who writes, "Hi, Emily and Ken. You brought up some great points last week. Loved the line, 'Ian is a resourceless loser.' So true. I can't see him being smart enough to pull off Trish's rape. I do believe he was drugged at the party as part of a revenge plot. The perp hoped to frame Ian, but somehow hasn't managed to do that yet. Or maybe it's to come. This is the first place I heard the realization that the Angler's Pub figured in a few storylines. That has to be a major clue. I doubt it's anyone in the band, unless Leo plays in the band. The guilty party has to have been in the series from episode 1 or 2 on."
Yeah, I think that's especially true now, because we have not brought back the caterers or the band yet, and I don't think they're going to come back.
Exactly. She writes, "The band, the caterers," or they write, "the band, the caterers, Nige and Aaron have entered too late in the series, and we haven't seen them enough.
Yeah.
It's driving me nuts. There are viewers out there convinced it has to be someone who's been in all three series, and they're focusing on Paul. No, just no."
Paul's been a really popular theory.
Mm-hmm. And he's been absent.
Yeah.
Yeah. You also mentioned Hardy's rapid-fire questioning, which worked against Danny and Aaron, but was also something Ellie complained about in Series 1. I can see where this works for him when someone is lying, but not when the person is innocent. He said he likes to light a fire under the suspect and see what mistakes he/she makes.
Yeah, the problem is definitely what he did with Ed this week.
Yes, yeah, I noticed that. I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot about that. The problem is, we know he screwed up the Sandbrook case the first time by only focusing on Lee. I wonder if he's going to do something similar with this case, and they'll only get the right person because Ellie takes a little bit more time and sees the whole picture. Many of us, and this is one I wasn't thinking about, many of us think Ellie will finally make DI in the last episode.
Maybe, I would like that.
But maybe at the expense of Hardy's job.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Jalola.
Yes, thank you. That's a lot to chew on.
Yeah, well, a lot, and I'm hoping, like, one of these days when we read, like, the previous week's email, it's going to be someone who is like, I wonder if this is the case. And, like, they just get it right.
That would be pretty awesome.
Yeah. And again, so open invitation to all the listeners, and there are hundreds of you.
Absolutely, yeah.
To just, well, you know, we won't read 100 email, but I'm, you know, it's open to everyone who wants to write in, because the feedback is great, theories are great, and you only have 2 more weeks to do it, so
yeah, ever.
Or, yeah. So we start episode 6 in Mark's dream, where a teenage Dan can't sleep, and Mark does like a really good job consoling him.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't check, but that just looked like it was the same actor, right?
For Danny. I don't know, but I would assume.
Yeah. So yeah, and he wakes up from that dream and he's crying and he's in the plumbing van, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
The murder van, as you called it last week.
Yeah, the Joe Miller murder machine. Alec and Ellie are, you know, they're at the office and they're realizing, okay, they need to get the facts straight for the chief super before the gold meeting. And all I can really gather is the gold meeting is just a thing they do with the other cops.
Yeah, that's what it seems like.
Yeah. So they're reviewing the case because, you know, this is basically like, this is it. We got to make the case for, like, I guess maybe continually using resources on this. And Ellie says, like, okay, well, we've gone from 65 men at the party and ruled out 42, leaving 23, of which we're really only closely looking at Ian, Jim, Clive, and Leo, the twine boy. they believe Leo has no connection to Jim, and therefore, like, no reason to be at Axhampton. They know his alibi is shady, but they don't know, or they're not aware of any connection between, you know, him and the Atwoods.
Right.
Though there are two that I can think of. One that I think only becomes clear this episode. Did you catch this? Any chance?
I don't know.
His football team, his football jersey said Atwoods Autos on it.
Oh, yes. I did see that.
Yeah. Yeah. So, like, so there's that. It's like, it's plausible, but not really realistic, I think, for Leo to not know who his sponsor is. And then Leo and Jim have both been to that Angler's Pub that I talked about last week, and Jalola brought up in the email today.
Right, that's true too.
So they've both been at the same pub, and he's like where it should say Arsenal or, like, you know, the name of your football team. It just says Atwood's Autos, and he really doesn't seem like he's got the money for that. But whatever.
Yeah. Honestly. Like, even, I don't know, people were talking about it last week, how did he afford Kath's party? And we're still not really sure, and they kind of throw a little shade on that in this episode.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so the connections are there, and I think we'll see, but something else I was thinking about, the whole Angler's Pub thing, is that, yeah, that could just be a cute name for, like a fish, you know, a sea town bar or something, but, I couldn't help but think, anglers fishermen. Were like thematically important.
Yeah, well, the fishermen. Yeah, it wasn't there's the fishing twine.
Yeah, the fishing twine.
Aaron's alibi is that he was fishing.
Yeah, well, I was just thinking the like an angler fish is like this devious thing with like a bright light that gets fish to come into it and it just eats it. Okay, so Trishaw light. Trish was lured away from this party, and maybe the other two, Lauren and Nira, they don't have like a reason. They don't have like, oh, I was lured away from something, but I don't know.
Yeah. I feel like angling is like fishing with a lure. So yeah.
I just think, yeah, there's definitely like a hook. Yeah. No, you're right. Just like something that like, yes, I just think there could be a thematic reason. I could be proven completely wrong by by next week's episode, but that's that. So then the police station, and then Officer Bob calls to report that Jim has been assaulted at his garage, and Alex says, "Grab your coats."
Grab your coats. Yes.
We're going over to the garage.
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to watch it until I guess yesterday night and said that the only thing he told you about this episode was grab your coats.
Grab your coats!
And so when I saw it, I was so happy.
Yeah. So at the garage, Jim doesn't take kindly to Alec and Ellie's questions because they're like,
no.
Like, why'd he beat you up? He just beat you up out of nowhere? For no reason at all.
He's like, kind of.
Just lock the psycho up and come back to me with some bloody sympathy. I liked Jim's line there, but I liked Ellie's better. Typical. A woman gets attacked.
And a man has to make, men have to make it, what is it?
Or? Like a man butt horns and make it about them. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so good. And it completely explains like most of the men have been doing this whole series.
Yeah.
Ed is in arguments with Ian, Jim, and everyone's had scenes to like dunk on each other. So whatever. So after talking to the gym, they go over to the farm shop, and Alec and Ellie arrest Ed for a formal police interview later that day. And in that interview, he admits why he beat Jim up. He's like, you know, why'd you beat him up? Well, he slept with Trish. And then during that interview, Ellie's like, oh shit, because she's found some new evidence.
Mm-hmm. The cards.
Right. She goes to ask Katie to be like, hey, Katie, do you mind getting Alec out of that interview? I have something to show him. And Katie's like, nah, can't do it. Won't do
and
it.
I forget exactly what she says. Oh, you're going to be in so much shit when I get back.
Yeah. That's when you know, like, oh, this is going to be the bad episode for Katie.
It's like, oh, Katie, yes, it's happening.
Mm-hmm. So Ellie grabs Alec herself. And, yeah, the florist cards from the farm shop match the ones Trish received, and blue twine was recovered from the farm shop.
Yeah.
Yeah, the radishes are covered in blue twine. Somehow I thought that was already, like, established. But it wasn't. I looked back, I'm like, I guess we haven't had it confirmed that the farm shop used the blue twine. This is the first time they're learning that.
Okay.
But something about it doesn't surprise me.
Like, yeah. I feel like everyone in Broadchurch is using this twine, though.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, no, they haven't encountered twine that it wasn't the blue twine yet.
Yeah, right? We haven't had any, like, tan twine or something.
Yeah. So they're talking about, we just got all this evidence. Then Katie interrupts to confess that Ed is her father, and she's thoroughly roasted, and then Ed is immediately, like, arrested after that.
Yeah,
and you can really tell their chief concern isn't like, "Oh, Katie, you idiot." It's like you have no idea. Like now, this case might not hold up in court, and especially I think after series two,
yeah,
their first concern is you need to leave. Give us your cell phone. Don't talk to us. Just leave.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well. Yeah. They're not going to make the same mistake that they've made twice. And now, even though they've been super careful, the fact that somebody else now might be ruining another case for them is just like, are you kidding me?
Mm-hmm. So they update their chief super about Katie, and they mention, oh, for the record, we just think she was stupid, not bent. and the chief super, I didn't note this down in the notes, but she felt a little bit guilty for like recommending her promotion, I guess, through the ranks.
Yeah, but they were like, you know.
Well, it sounds like the police are kind of just taking whoever they can get.
Yeah.
Like Ellie makes it clear that someone like Katie could get to her position with 6 months.
Yeah, which was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It was interesting to see Ellie kind of just, like, really unload like that.
Yeah. So the chief super gives them permission to do the gold meeting, talk to Katie, and then brief the press.
Yeah.
Which just seemed like a lot of formal police stuff. Some of the stuff is so hard to like Google and get good results for.
I'm
like,
right.
What's gold meeting? No results. Gold meeting UK? Nah. Gold meeting UK police? No. Nah. So, if any police officers are listening.
Yeah, please let us know what it is because we don't.
So, Beth and Sahana track down Neera, who is our third victim, though second chronologically. because yes, she was raped before Trish, but years after Lauren was raped.
Laura.
So she's absolutely not talking to the police again, or she never talked to the police, and she's really not open to the idea now.
Yeah, she's really not about it.
Yeah, and I get it, and I kind of like that we have this this archetype.
Yeah.
Because, like, again, props to the show for, like, I think basically featuring your three types. Laura, who comes forward years later. Trish, who does a few days after. And then Nira, who's like, I'm just going to try to move on with my life. Because if I tell my family and my friends, I'm always going to be the girl who's raped. I'm never just going to be myself again.
Right.
But she does reveal a bit of information to Beth, which is that she called car breakdown services before the attack happened.
Yes, and they never showed up.
Right. And that is leading a lot of people to point fingers to Jim.
And Leo as well. Or not Leo. What's the other one? Clive. Because someone who's like a taxi dispatch could be listening in on a radio or something like that.
Yes. Yeah, I saw that theory. They also connected that when the breakdown car breaks down, who shows up? Clive.
Right. Yeah.
So there's that. So Alec and Ellie take Katie out to the beach to ask her what she told Ed. And I think as someone said, like, on Reddit this week, oh, the obligatory sweeping beach
show. Yes, yes, yes. I did like that.
Yeah. But what she told Ed basically amounts to nothing.
So she tells us, which I guess we're supposed to believe.
Yeah, and this far into the season, I think we can take her at face value.
Yeah.
Kind of this whole season, it's been like, oh, what did she tell Ed to compromise his? Now it seems like it might have been nothing.
Yeah.
But the reason that plot point matters is for how long she kept it secret.
Right. And the fact that, again, now it ties back to season two with the whole court procedures.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, and if she puts it in jeopardy, I think this whole series will feel funny at the end.
Yeah.
Like, this needs to end with, like, there's no way, like, we know, period, that we need to end the show with no question about how the trial is going to go, basically.
True.
So Katie's like, oh, yeah, it's nothing. It's not what you think. Like, we've been out of touch for 12 years, barely talk. But what's really key here is, like you said, Ellie's glorious roasting. A chance for her to just unload.
Yeah, on Katie. Ellie unleashed.
Yeah, and
we also just, really, I think, for the first time, Ellie kind of reflects on what it means to be, a woman in this position. Yeah, and a cop. Yeah, yeah.
Just because, like, yeah, all her years of working,
right?
And Katie is like the younger one who takes advantage of the people who led the way.
People who paved the way. Yeah.
I also the entire time I was half listening to this and half thinking, like, wow, Ellie from season one could never do that.
Yeah. Well, actually, I remember, because season one, the very beginning, she's pretty salty about Alec getting the promotion and not her. And I don't know if there is some talk of, sexism or that kind of thing. I really don't remember. But it's much more low-key. And I think she's just talking about it with another woman in the office. Mm. Whereas now she's, Ellie's... frustration is in full force this episode.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Oh my god, yeah. Yes, that will come up again.
We'll get to that.
But she composes herself and gives the public briefing.
Yeah.
Which, we don't really learn anything, but we do see everyone watching and listening.
Yeah. Those scenes always make me laugh, a little bit, just because,
The whole town
stops. The whole town is watching.
Yeah. And, one of the most clever versions of that, though, was that Ed was featured in that montage, too. And I'm like, oh, I guess you could hear that from the jail cell.
I guess this is true.
Because it's happening right outside, like, yeah. the police station.
True.
So.
I was kind of laughing because, like, Daisy's, like, on the beach with her iPad watching it, but, like, Trish's daughter's in school, so, like, yeah. like you know. it made me laugh a little bit.
Yeah, well, everyone's got to be doing something different. Some people got to listen to this on the radio. Or it was Trish was watching on ITV News.
Hey, that's the channel we broadcast this show on.
Yeah.
I just love those, like, little kind of, like, corny moments in Broadchurch that, like, you know, the whole town is going to play football together.
Yeah. Yeah, there are things that happen for plot convenience, and I'm never going to hold it against the show. What Broadchurch doesn't need to be more realistic. That's not what we've all signed up for.
No.
God, yeah, it's probably something closer to, like, a radio play or something.
Yeah.
So, anyways. Oh, no, I did like this part from Edley's public briefing, which was when she said, like, you know, she was encouraging people to come forward with information, and she said the attacker is someone's husband, someone's son, someone's brother, someone's friend or colleague. And it's like, damn, right.
Yeah, it is.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and that kind of really cuts to the heart of season one, too, where the town starts to turn against each other because someone among them is a murderer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I love, 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 love this scene. So Leah meets her father at school and demands to know what he was doing in their house. And he's just like, I don't know what you're talking about.
and she's like, not dumb.
Yeah. So Leah gives her dad an ultimatum. Clap, clap. Good job, Leah. Here's my spare locker keys. If mom's laptop is in there at the end of the day, I'll take it home and I don't have to tell anyone. And he's just like, I don't know what you're talking about.
Gosh, and, he's the worst.
Yeah, I love she said, I really need you to not be acting weirdly today.
Yes.
And then... You're supposed to be parenting me, not the other way around.
Yeah, Leah's all kinds of awesome.
Yeah, the only problem with Series 3 so far is that she's only had, like, 5 lines of dialogue, maybe. True. 6. So, she seems like a really good kid, despite the broken marriage she was raised in.
Yeah, can, like, can Chloe and Daisy and Leah just form, like, an awesome, like, friends support group?
Or spin-off series?
Yeah, yeah.
God, yeah, that could be, like, a spinoff series that's kind of like a, what are those, like, mystery books that, like, you read in elementary school?
The Babysitter's Club.
Oh, yeah, something like that. Anyways, so Kath goes to the garage and brings Jim's clothes, essentially trying to kick him out of the house.
Yeah.
This is something that crossed my mind, not while watching the show, but while taking the notes. Ooh. If Jim... is in debt and Kath is a cashier, then everyone could be out of a house pretty soon.
What do you
mean? If Jim's on the verge of bankruptcy, like, they have a house, they just had this party, and I think that's part of why Jim's able to convince her to, like, hey, let's move out of town and try to start over. Because, like, their faux life is only going to last for, like, so much longer.
Yeah.
If, like, true. But, yeah, on the whole, small scene. And I think not a lot of people are taking the bait on, like, Jim and Kath are moving out of town. Doesn't that make you suspect them? Though it might make you suspect Jim for coming up with the idea. Not sure, though.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think Kath maybe is a little more fishy just because, like, Trish kind of makes us believe, like, why would Kath want to leave this town? Because she seems like she's invested in, like, the town's
kind of
day-to-day.
Mm-hmm. Or being, like, the cool kid.
Yeah, yeah.
Even, like, she's even though queen bee, yeah. Even though she's 50.
Yeah.
yeah, so after stalking Joe for days, Joe up and decides to tell Mark to cut it out. But Mark tells Joe, hey, look, well, you know, in less kind terms, I just want to talk. But Joe is smart enough to just not implicate himself before checking Mark's pockets.
Yeah.
Somehow something that I didn't even think of.
Yeah, I was kind of like, I mean, maybe Joe learned some things in prison, but I have to feel like the people in prison weren't like super kind to Joe. But yeah, I don't know. Like, I mean, it's totally fitting for Mark to totally want to be like, yeah, I'm gonna get him. Like, I got my phone recording, whatever. You know, because he's just kind of a doofus like that.
Mm-hmm.
But Joe, it does not really seem like a. I don't know. Maybe he watched a lot. Well, I mean, his wife is a police officer, so I don't know.
Yeah. Well, it's been a long time. I kind of forget Joe's character attributes.
It's true. I mean, yeah, he's just a weird character because all that we knew about him in season one is kind of a lie. Although it seems like his behavior, no one suspected him because his behavior was consistent with what it had been, where he was just kind of like genial husband.
Well, he was a nurse, right?
EMT, I think. EMT? EMS. Yeah.
You gotta be pretty smart.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's
true.
Yeah, and so he makes Mark empty his pockets, and this knife comes out.
Yeah, all the murder machine weapons.
Yeah, he's like, oh, is that what you came to do? And I kind of like this from Joe.
Yeah.
He's like, what about your family?
Yeah.
And he's like, I don't, and Mark comes back, shoots back with, I don't have a family, you took that from me.
Yeah.
And there's this kind of, like, Joe doesn't really extend it, but I think as the audience you can think about this, it was like, what Joe did was a mistake. Like, he accidentally killed Danny, but like, Mark is contemplating intentionally murdering Joe.
Yeah, true.
And like how they would destroy each other's families was completely different.
Yeah.
But Mark's not that type of person.
No.
Da da da. Although, da, da. We'll get to it. Yeah. Well, yeah.
Oh, I mean, like, Joe was definitely making questionable choices that led to him killing Danny, you know? So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Mark demands that Joe tell him everything so that he can try to, like, finally move on with his life.
Yeah.
And Joe obliges, but off screen.
Yeah.
Did you want to see that conversation?
Well, I don't know.
Or is it just a series one recap?
I think we saw the most important things, which was that, because for Mark, it was very important to him that he always thought that he could have saved Danny. But then Joe kind of tells him, whether it's truthful, and I guess it's truthful. I mean, I don't know that Joe would kind of tell him something not true, whether to help or hurt him, that it was already too late. You know, he was already dead. And it's kind of like a weirdly, like, it felt real in the way that sometimes when you go there with a person and you're just kind of laying it all out there and you can just kind of talk in terms that you wouldn't normally talk in already. So Joe is very upfront about, like, no, it was too late. Danny was dead. You couldn't have saved him.
Yeah, this... Maybe we'll just go through the entire conversation since they intersplice a lot of scenes here.
Yeah, I think it's better to just probably talk about it all right now.
Yeah, so, like, he apologizes to Mark. Like, and he says, like, I know you want me in prison, but look at my life here. I'm only here because I'm not brave enough to kill myself. Which they might put on the sign while you're entering Liverpool. But that's a dig at Liverpool, a place I've never been and know nothing about. But, like, yeah, so Mark comes to Joe with his theory, like, oh, I was in the car park. I could have saved Danny if only I... went up to the hut, which seems like a weird thing to be fixed on, but nonetheless, Mark is fixed on it.
Yeah, well, Mark is a person who likes to fixate on things, because now that we're psychoanalyzing Mark, I think it gives him the feeling of control, or that he can control things when so much is spiraling out of control.
Yeah, and like you said, like, Joe is just like, now by the time I saw you in the car park, his body was, like, already on the beach and I was cleaning up. And
it's like, I don't know if that hurts or helps Mark.
I think that's a relief. That's like something. Yeah. I think he is gaining something, though. It's obviously not bringing him peace.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird because, yeah, I think on one hand he's relieved that, like, it wasn't him, it wasn't it wasn't that he didn't do anything that night, because he couldn't have done anything. But on the other hand, it's like, that seems to have been sustaining him for all these years, the idea that he could have done something. And now that that idea has been taken away and proved false, it feels like there's just kind of nothing left.
Yeah, I wonder, God, I wonder what the hell is in the book. Like, is the book called Danny by Mark Latimer? I forget what the name of the book.
I think it might be, yeah.
Yeah. But he says to Joe, I can't live with what you've done, and I'm not strong enough to make you pay.
Yeah.
I think on some level, Joe, if Mark was looking to kill Joe, I think Joe might have made it easy for Mark to do so.
But, well, yeah. I mean, I don't think Joe's not really living a life. He's just kind of more surviving.
Yeah. And we'll get to it. I mean, it's no spoiler that Mark kills himself. But I think this episode kind of lays out, like, you have here two men who are really just maybe you'd say struggling with their lives, or they're living unhappy lives, and you have Joe who is going to run away from his would you call it maybe responsibility, or run away from his blame and just survive his life in an unhappy job, probably never make any friends there.
Yeah.
Or you can go the Mark route, but I that's the end of the whole conversation between the two of them.
Yeah.
So two other scenes happen, and then the show intercut other scenes, I guess, guys, like a whole 15 minutes of Joe and Mark would have been nice. Needed to cut away from, like, Joe recapping season one, right? So,
right.
There is a scene in here where Beth gives Neera this really harsh talk that a sexual violence advisor should not give.
Yeah.
Though Neera is not a client, I still don't know about this, like, this whole position of tough luck. You have the responsibility to help out the police and, like, help other women. Because without you, we can't fight back. This feels like Beth getting maybe a little bit too personally involved.
Yeah.
But for the good of other people. But
right. Well, it's kind of just that. I mean, Beth is obviously new at this, and she hasn't really. This is her first case. I mean, so she doesn't really, and it's becoming huge, and it's. Mm-hmm. I could understand where she's coming from. But I also, you know, it wasn't handled in necessarily the best way.
Mm-hmm. So, I think you called it an awkward breakfast, but I think this might be a dinner scene just based on timestamps of what everyone else is doing. Let's just say at dinner, Grandpa Miller says some really gross shit about rape.
Grandpa Miller is not great. No. Or actually, it wouldn't be Miller.
Right, yeah, whatever her maiden name
Gramps is. Gramps is not awesome.
Yeah, no. And Ellie makes Tom crystal clear about consent. And then that's the moment when the porn plot returns.
Yeah, yay, porn.
So Tom's phone rings, and he like kind of begs her, like, you don't have to look at that. And upon inspection, Tom has even more porn on his phone than he had before.
Tom, the fuck?
And it's from Michael Lewis, who gets it from his dad, Clive the taxi driver.
Yep. Well, I think I said to you, like, this is, like, the most awkward breakfast since Breaking Bad. Yeah. And it was just a horrible, horrible meal for all involved.
Yeah. So there's that. Then Ellie smashes his phone and his laptop with a hammer.
Yeah.
And some people were hung up on, like, could she have destroyed evidence?
Well, so in season one, don't they recover stuff off of a smashed computer?
Yeah, that's what someone said. So for consistency's sake, I think you have to, you know, unless she does something drastic to the remains of the computer, like throws them in garbage and they get it wet or something, right?
Yeah.
I don't know. So, but the other thing is, all this might tell us is something about Clive's behavior or Clive's household.
Yeah.
Because there's this, like, this idea keeps circulating, and it could be true, that like, oh, what if there was video of these rapes and Clive has them, and that's what Tom and, you know, and at this point, Ellie has seen two victims' faces, and she's not recognizing, you know, it's not to say that, like, that's the first thing that would show up on Tom's computer, right. But, nor is it that, like, oh, she's investigating,
right, and it's not like she's seeing somebody bound and gagged.
Right, yeah, so, like, I just don't know about it.
I don't know, yeah.
And I know we were just giving Broadchurch, like, a pass to do silly things, like have everyone listen,
yeah,
and watch the news report all at once. But this, the way technology and porn is handled here feels really, like we talked about it before, like Ellie is super sensitive, not only because of the case she's covering, but because of her husband, Joe, and
right.
Like, so she's very careful about how she's trying to raise Tom, but at the same time, the way the technology is handled here, it's like, what is Tom up to that, like, it's like...
Yeah, his phone is loaded with porn. Like, what is he doing? Like, yeah.
Turns it on, and then, like, oh, there's porn.
Right, like Tom, what are you doing there?
Yeah, and this idea that, like, it's being downloaded by Clive and then shared.
Yeah, it's all, like, a little bit silly.
Yeah, it all kind of reads like someone who's never found porn on the internet before. Though, England did pass some, like, porn laws that, like...
Yes, this is true.
That, like, forbade, like, some types of, like, I think BDSM from being filmed professionally. Or maybe even streamed on the internet. I don't know. There were some protests.
Yeah, you know, I feel like that was actually happening the summer that I was there.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So, meanwhile, on the other, like, complete polar opposite emotional spectrum, Alec and Daisy are eating chips on the beach, and it's, like, really, really cute. And Alec Alec gives a proper good dad pep talk.
Yeah, he's, like, the one example of, like, pretty spot on parenting this episode.
Yeah. Know? So I wrote
good
down
job, Alec.
I basically wrote down, like, the whole speech here. Because Daisy's telling him, like, oh, I packed my bags. I'm going back to mom. And he says, stay here. Fight a wee bit. I'll help you even not have to smack a teenage boy in the face. You're not a wee little girl anymore. You've got to face up to the world. The future's not inevitable. It's down to you. And then he starts, like, apologizing for, like, you know, not being there at certain points in her life. Missing her grow up. And he's like, you know, I got sick and almost died, right? But I didn't die, and that's because I'm meant to be here in this stupid place with its stupid cliffs.
Yeah.
Doing this job, looking after you. And I'm like, aww.
Yeah, it was quite... I think, like, I don't know if it was last week or one of the weeks I talked about him kind of being, like, Russ Cole in True Detective, where it's, like, you know, underneath all, like, the nihilistic bullshit that they're, like, really just looking for something to make them, like, happy and find a purpose. And I was like, oh, yeah. Alec.
Yeah. And then Katie shows up.
And then Katie shows up.
Crashes the party and kind of off camera tells Alec about the time Ed hit her mother.
Yeah.
So there's that. At Ed's second formal police interview, he starts with the line, in the absence of evidence, you've gone for the textbook, blame the black guy.
Like, yeah.
It's like, all right, Ed. You can sit there and believe all you want that he didn't deserve to be put into this box. But this whole interview boils down to, like, them presenting evidence, Ed going, that's not illegal. And they're like, no, but it is odd. And then he goes, don't make it weird. And they're like, but it is. So I really do love this scene.
Yeah, I heartily enjoyed it.
And how it ramps up. Because the entire time, no matter how weird it gets, I'm still shaking my head like, this guy isn't it. This guy's not the rapist. No matter how weird things got. And weirdest of all, there were 5,219 photos of mostly of Trish on Ed's phone dating back almost 10 years.
Yeah. Super weird.
Yeah. Also, another point of, like, maybe the writing staff unfamiliar with some technology. I don't know of any phone that doesn't max out capacity after around 2,000 photos.
True. I don't know. Maybe they had gotten to his cloud account or something. Yeah. I don't know.
10 years back. Wait, yeah, photos 10 years back. Are smartphones 10 years old? I don't know. But I was like, the important part was, Ed's a fucking stalker.
Yeah.
And he's like, don't call it that.
And it's like,
I'm like, these are not romantic photos, yeah. Ed.
Nope.
And he I love this burn so much. Because Ed says, ah, you want to turn this into something that it's not. And Alex's like, oh, I think that's what you want to do. And I'm like, oh, yes. My God.
Oh, shit.
This episode's great. Even if Ed's not the killer, at least he got, like, taken down, like, a few pegs. Or, like, like, in another life, Ed is, like, a fedora-wearing m'lady type dude.
Oh, my God, he is.
And Alec and Ellie are just like, all right, dude. Yeah, all right, dude. Listen. Relax. You're not in love with Trish. You're obsessed with Trish. Oh, you know what? Maybe this is even weirder than 5,000 photos. You decide. It turns out Ed has been sleeping in a car parked outside Trish's house for,
super weird.
10 nights.
Yeah. I think that the pictures are probably weirder just because it's been going on for, like, 10 years. And at least for this one, you can kind of pretend, like, oh, like, maybe he's trying to do a nice thing, even though, again, it's super weird and not a nice thing, but I think the pictures are personally creepier. But yeah. They're both super creepy.
Yeah, I thought that's where you would land, because, like, 5,000 photos, 10...
That's a lot.
10 years. That's active stalking for no good reason. Yeah.
We're reaching, like, Tom Miller excessive levels of porn territory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so Alec kind of pokes at Ed, saying, oh, you're an obsessive loser. And the only reason you attacked Jim is because he had a taste of what you couldn't. And that makes Ed stand up and, like, I'm going to fight you. And it's like, he's like, oh, but wait, police interview. Right. So yeah. this whole scene ends with, like, hey, Ed, we need you to show us what you wore to Kath's party, which means they're going to need to go through Ed's house. End scene. Then Kath shows up to Trish's house. Not as I thought, to maybe issue an apology, but instead to tell Trish, you have to stop contacting me and Jim.
Yeah, heads, she's heads like, up. Okay.
Yeah, like, in a town like this, good luck. And I love this because Trish returns fire this whole time.
Yeah, Trish is great.
Yeah.
In this scene.
This first one's maybe not, like, you can call great, but it is, like, a good burn. Because she's like, what kind of friend sleeps with her, like, best friend's husband? And Trish is like, maybe if you gave him what he needed. One. Two. She's like, oh, me and Jim are going to move somewhere. And she's like, you'd be a no one somewhere else. You'd hate that. You behave like you're better than everyone else. But it doesn't matter who was queen bee in fifth year. And then burn number three. Kath is like taken back and offended by Trish. And she's like, look, I know you're not the same person you were before the rape. And Trish is like, no, no, no. I'm the person more now than ever. Now get out. And she's like, oh, hey, wait, no. Not that way. Not through my house.
Yeah.
The back way. Slink out like your husband. And I'm like, drink that wine. Drink that wine.
Like, yeah, and I'm like, it's kind of, I guess that maybe Trish wasn't this, like, you know, sassy maybe beforehand, but it's like, if this is, I mean, when the flashback we see of Trish, you know, she's having fun at the party and whatever, and it's like, yeah, this Trish is awesome.
Yeah. Well, like, Trish hasn't had time. Like, at this point, it seems like we're maybe coming close to 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And it's like she's starting, like, you know, it's just, you know, change is happening. Mm-hmm. And it's at the end of this scene where Leah tells Trish about her dad and the laptop.
Yes.
And but that's largely off camera, because then we then shift to Ian trying to give Leo the laptop in broad daylight.
Ugh.
But Leo dummy. Leo being the smart one isn't touching it.
Yeah, I like how Leo is the smart one in this operation.
Yeah. Leo knows, like, okay, the police are everywhere. Yeah. And he knows now's not the time. Leo's downfall might be the fact that he did this favor for Ian in the first place. I mean, it probably wasn't a favor. It was probably for money. But, you know, at the time, he probably didn't think, like, well, he, like, if he really had nothing to do with the rapes, then, right? Like, it's complicated. Because, like, all right. Like, well, I guess we'll find out in the next few days how smart Leo is. But, like, if this was a premeditated thing and they were targeting Trish, then I might have not done that for Ian. Right, unless, like, oh, putting like the whatever spy, or putting like the webcam control thing, if that's the case, maybe Ian thought he was the only one monitoring Trish's computer, but maybe Leo was too.
True.
I don't know. So yeah, Leo's not taking the computer back.
No.
And at Ed's house, the place is being thoroughly investigated. And Beth calls to Ellie to relay Nira's information about the breakdown car and the field, yada yada. And they find Ed's suit from the party, and that's covered in mud.
Yes.
And has blue twine in the pockets.
Jesus Christ. It's just so damning.
The only thing they won't find in the house are the red condoms, because Ed's not getting any. And... womp womp.
Womp womp.
So, after that, we cut to the Latimer house, where Beth is telling Chloe that she is divorcing Mark, which she is surprisingly not okay with.
Yeah, I was like, I thought that was kind of weird.
Yeah, you texted me, like, plot twist, Chloe upset about her mom wanting a divorce.
Yeah.
And maybe it's just, like, a parent-child difference. Where a child's never going to come down on the side of you guys should get a divorce, and the parent is like, oh, we're just, we can patch things up. Like, and which is the line they cross, which is Beth is thinking this has been a long time coming. Chloe this whole time has been thinking this is just a sticky period that they can patch up. And I feel for Chloe, especially how things are going to end at the end of the day.
Right.
But I especially feel for her because she's just got that really, like, what's happened to this family.
Yes.
And it's like, I don't know, girl. Your brother was murdered.
Yeah, it's just, she just has such a bad string of luck. And, I mean, and now she's going to have to live with that horrible guilt of, like, feeling that she could have done something for Mark.
Right, yeah. So, after that, after a tip from Trish comes in, Alec and Ellie go to visit the school to retrieve her laptop from Ian. Yeah. And I was trying to think of something funnier than dumbass Ian. And I maybe thought the only thing on top that is Ian the human Magikarp. Because he is just fucking like a fish out of water. He, like, Alec and Ellie show up and he just gives the laptop away. And I'm like...
Yeah.
Did you fix the thing with the laptop that is going to be incriminating? I'm just like, I'm scratching my head there, like, nothing? Yeah. Are you gonna do like a laptop switch and give him the fake laptop or something? Like, I don't know. And then he thinks this is real slick, but I hope Alec and Ellie see right through it. But he knows that Ed's been arrested, so he tries to like bury Ed with like this sexual harassment story. Oh, like 2 years ago, Trish was being sexually harassed, so I had to go have a word with Ed. And it's like, we saw how that went. The last time you had a word with Ed, he denied you a caravan. It's like, it's,
yeah, you're not having words with Ed.
Yeah. And then finally, Chloe gets a phone call from Mark, in which he tells her, I've done my best for you, Chloe. I'm sorry if sometimes that wasn't enough. And she goes, like, I love you, Dad. And he goes, I love you too, darling. And those are Mark's last words. As Mark. We get the shot of Mark at the top of the cliffs, and I'm like, no. And then it cuts to him in his boat, which he has had since season one. And then
wasn't the boat like a part of the?
Yeah, they find Danny's blood on it at some point. Yeah. It's a huge part of why they arrest Mark in like the first place in like episode right. two or something. And then after seeing another vision of teenage Danny, he jumps into the water to slowly drown himself.
Yeah.
So two pieces here. Bravo to the music.
Yes.
For carrying a silent scene and making it super impactful.
Oh, yeah. Oliver Arnold just is perfect for this show. Mm-hmm. Everything he's done has just been pitch perfect.
Yeah, I wish I could find that music on YouTube right now, but the I feel like the soundtracks to Broadchurch become more readily available only after the season's aired.
Yeah.
But also bravo to Andrew Buchan for like closing out the Mark chapter.
Yeah.
And like you know, this is certainly the episode to give your best performance, and I think he might have.
Yeah.
Even though I think there were times when we were bothered by the Mark plot this season.
Yeah. I mean, Mark's just kind of a dumb doof, but yeah, the acting's always been, you know, great.
Yeah, and even if Mark's decisions have been really questionable,
right,
you could still really, like, sympathize with this guy. And actually, I'll jump to Redditor Haystack67, who I thought gave, like, a really good, like, eulogy kind of for Mark. They write, Broadchurch has always excelled at writing characters who aren't black and white, and this is no different. Mark can neither forgive nor kill Joe, and he dies under the backdrop of his most positive aspect, his unrelenting love for his family.
Yeah.
And, I wasn't personally moved to tears, but I definitely could see a universe where I was, and I definitely understand everyone who was.
That's how I feel too.
Yeah, I was like, when I knew, like, the thing was, it all happened so slowly that I was able to, like, I was, like, processing it. Like, I definitely didn't leave that episode going, like, wow, I'm ready to podcast. I'm like, oh, whew,
right,
wow.
Right.
Sure. It was like, I'm glad to have the extra 24 hours to like think about the episode, because we have lost a character who has been around since the beginning. And I don't know what there were some people who were like confused by the shot of Mark at the top of the cliff and then in the ocean.
I think it could be read as a hallucination.
The water part.
Yeah.
And that he jumped, and that everything afterwards was just like a poetic way of describing.
Yeah.
Because what they showed for TV definitely works better than like showing a CGI body falling off a cliff or something.
Right, right. However we're meant to read it, I think it works.
It reads pretty clearly. Though, if we were talking pure ease of the suicide, I couldn't imagine too much worse than just slowly floating your way to death.
Yeah, I was also thinking that too, because I remember like in I don't know why I remember this, but I remember in high school we read Antigone, or no, not Antigone, wow, we did read Antigone, but the Odyssey, and we had to watch this horrible movie version of it, and like I guess Odysseus's mom like drowns herself in grief, and it's just like, it just looks so silly because she just walks into the water and then she just doesn't resurface, which is not at all how that happens.
Right.
So it kind of reminded me of that a little bit.
Well, what poet did they give that treatment to? There's like a poet who's like in like every movie version of her suicide. That's how they film it. It's like her walking into the water.
Really?
And like, I don't know. Maybe I'm thinking of something else. But like, people, you can't just walk into the water and then never return.
Right. Not so much how it works. Oh, wait. The ending of. That's the ending of
Doctor Who episode?
Oh, no. It's the ending of The Awakening, Kate Chopin.
I don't know.
Okay. We were not thinking of the same thing. I'm like, of course, it's The Awakening. And you're like, huh?
But, I didn't have a source for this one, but someone on Twitter wrote, like, in Trish's story is the plot of series 3, but Danny's story is still the heart.
Yeah.
Which I can kind of read. I don't know how much there is to say, except I'm going to be really interested in how everyone, what the fallout of this is. Because you had Beth a few days ago ready to let Mark kill Joe or do something stupid. Like, she was like, you know, she herself said you can't save someone who doesn't want to be saved. She herself was ready to let him make really questionable decisions. But how would she feel now that Mark is gone? How much would she blame herself? Or would she stay true to the it was his decision thing? Will we see Chloe have to struggle with this? And to some extent,
a lot to cover.
Yeah, like Alec and Ellie would have reactions to this. Alec maybe less sympathetic. I could imagine him just like raising his eyebrows or going, but
what? Yeah.
Yeah. What? Yeah. Just like exasperated. Like, just another thing. but yeah. That's it for like plot stuff. But something about Mark dying just feels like it deserves a better eulogy. So I might try to find if not the exact music that was used, maybe Take My Leave of You, which someone has now analyzed on Reddit, saying like, oh, it looks like the series 3 credit music was maybe talking about the water or like Mark's suicide this whole time.
It's so possible, but I don't know.
Yeah, I've always thought the lyrics were kind of abstracted. Yeah. So I think, you know, I'll let that play us out, because his music is brilliant and it's defined Broadchurch the whole way through. So, and of course, if you have any predictions, listeners, about how this whole thing shakes out.
Yes, please.
You really only have like one more episode to do that on, huh? Or two.
Technically,
more.
Yeah. Unless we get like a ton of feedback about the ending. Mm-hmm. I could see us, you know,
doing a feedback or wrap up episode. But Fargo
is gonna be coming.
Yeah. So, and the thing I'll say too, though, is that you can only write like your season 6 reactions or your episode 6 reactions and your episode 7 reactions, and that's it. You have like 2 more chances to come up with theories.
Yes.
No stress, but or no one stress. More chance.
Yeah, one more chance actually.
Whew. All right.
Come through.
Yeah. And so you can always write your email to cbrigadepodcast@gmail.com. And that's it for the Cbrigade. And we'll catch y'all next week.
All right.
Bye.
Bye.